more I attend them, the more I feel the relevance of them to this community, to ourselves, and what we do every day. It is important, and it's lovely to see you here, commemorating the death of Albert Sycamore. James will say a little bit for us, and then we'll have some strong lads at the back there, and they're going to help ring the bell for us, and then we'll have a prayer to end with.
To West Street, perhaps in New York. They just lived a couple of doors down from the school there. Albert had five brothers and sisters, and they all went to the Ewell schools. The school was very cramped, very dark. It was lit by gas lights and heated by gas heating, which was actually poisoning the children and the teachers. They all suffered from dreadful headaches and sickness. It got very stuffy when the heating was on, but then when they opened the window, it got freezing cold. And the rain came in, and the children were all off school with colds over the next few days, whenever they did that. The children, in general, weren't very diligent about attending school, I'm afraid. And there were lots of distractions, like travelling circuses that came to town. Lots of boys sang in the church choir, and some they just skipped school to sing at weddings, for example. And of course, there were some races twice a year in those days, which so eventually the teachers just gave up and declared the school closed because so many kids were biking off to watch those. He went through the infant school there and then up to the middle school. He was a very able pupil actually. He reached what was called Standard 7 in those days, and very few of our men reached that level of education when they were young. That would have involved more basic reading, so they would have been reading poems by poems and plays by Shakespeare and Milton, people like that, and they would be encouraged to do a lot of independent study rather than just learning by rote as the younger children were doing. And some of the older children, like Albert, who were more advanced, actually helped teach the younger children. The schools in those days usually only had one or two teachers, and they had lots and lots of children to teach, so they relied very heavily on their older and more able pupils to help out with the teaching. You might perhaps have expected Albert to go on to grammar school, having reached that standard, and maybe he did try for the 11 plus, we don't know. But he left school at age 13 and a half, just shy of the normal leaving age of 14, to go and work as a houseboy, probably one of the local big houses in Ewell. But he soon found a new job, working as a nursery gardener. Now, you will probably, most of you remember Sycamore's nursery in Ewell. We don't think it's that one, we don't know which one it is, but there were one or two nursery gardens operating in the area at the time. He got his family moved to Meadow Walk, also in Ewell. He continued to live there until he got married in 1909 to Beatrice Mary Richings. They married in Maidenhead, so it's quite a long way away. I don't really know how they met. But when they got married, she came back to live with Albert and his parents for a few months. She was actually about 4 months pregnant when they got married. It was the traditional way of getting engaged for most of our men, actually. And so 5 months later, a baby boy arrived. And they soon moved away to Sutton, living in Collingwood Road, where Albert's gave up nursery gardening, became a domestic gardener. He worked at one of the big houses around there. There were still some big estates in Sutton at the time, and they were very soon and very quickly vanishing. So he briefly moved back home. Maybe his house was the house he worked at. It was one of those that was knocked down for rows of modern villas that were being erected at the time. And he worked as a jobbing gardener, just doing the gardening in people's houses up and down the road, for example. And then he found a more secure position with accommodation here in Banstead at a house called Gerrards Lodge, which stands, or used to stand, where the Ford garage is today. And the house survived through until the late 1940s, when it was knocked down, and a new building, Prospect Garage, was built there. It had a very, very large garden, which stretched quite a long way down Garratts Lane, so needed a full-time garden. Actually, we're going to be commemorating two gardens from that same house this year, actually, funny enough. And Albert worked in the garden and the orchard there, and they had another child, son, in the spring of 1914. With a young family, it's probably understandable that Albert didn't want to rush away into a war that probably at the time seemed like it was going to be over fairly quickly anyway. And he was still at home working at Gerrards Lodge in the autumn of 1915 when he attested with the army under the Derby scheme. After the peak of voluntary enlistment earlier in the war, the number of people enrolling to join the army was falling off quite rapidly, and we were running out of men. So a new scheme was launched by Lord Derby, the same chap or the same family that gave the name to the Derby of the race. And in that scheme, people would be visited at their homes by a canvasser, and he would ask them on the spot whether they would join up or not. And he would get them to sign attestation forms and enrol. The perk you got for doing this was the choice of whether you went to the army straight away or whether you delayed your service. And you also got to choose which unit you served in. Now, most people knew the conscription was coming. So a lot of our men around this time, they signed up taking the chance to defer their service to later. And that's what Albert did. So he signed up with the Bedfordshire Regiment, which several people from his school served in. Maybe they were friends and they all decided as a group that they were going to join. And he, as a married man with children, was called up in the spring of 1916, a couple of months after conscription kicked in for everybody else, or the younger men in the country, rather. After some time training, he went out to France with the 4th Bedfordshires, and he probably joined them in trenches in a fairly comfortable, cushy sector at Cologne, which was used to introduce new troops to trench life. It was quiet. There hadn't been any fighting there for quite a long time. The line ran through a ruined village, and all the houses in those days had cellars. And the previous occupants of the line had rescued all the bed frames and mattresses from upstairs from the ruined houses, and they dragged them down into the cellars. And it was actually quite a comfortable place to be. And many men remember that was the only time they got to sleep on a soft bed in the entire time they were out in France. It didn't last for very long, though, and they were soon moved down to the Somme. It was eating through our men at a great rate. So most men that came to France at that time, sooner or later, and usually sooner, ended up fighting on the Somme. So the Somme battlefield, at the very start of the battle, was sort of an L shape, and the British had managed to push the bottom of the L up and shortened it, and the French had sort of pushed outside, where you see a sort of a lightning strike, sort of a shadow. And in the autumn of 1916, just as the bad weather was setting in that would eventually bring the battle to an end, an attack was made on the sort of the point, the corner of the L, and trying to push sideways, eastwards along the valley of the River Ouvre. They had to go through the villages of Beaumont-Hamel and Beaucourt, which are both very heavily fortified. Although the villages were in ruins, they had cellars and lots of piles of bricks and low walls through which people can hide. And the Bedfordshires were attached to the Royal Naval Division, which were units comprised of Royal Marines and Naval Reservists who didn't have a post on a ship. And they'd all been put in khaki and given rifles and sent off to the Western Front. They'd done really well fighting in France and also previously in Gallipoli. And they got a reputation as a good fighting force. So on the morning of the 13th of November 1916, they went into action at 5:45. The Navy men were at the front and they went through. If you were here in November last year, we commemorated Able Seaman George Bryan, Burr Heathbrand, who fell with the Navy that day. They encountered a stronghold. They didn't know it was there. It was manned by hundreds of Germans and lots bristling with machine guns. It was a really, really foggy day, so they didn't know exactly where it was. They just knew that they were being shot at. They didn't know exactly where they were because it was a foggy day, so they couldn't call in any artillery support, otherwise they risked being shelled by their own guns. So they did their best to pin the defenders down and sort of get round it. Albert's battalion came in about an hour after the Navy men did. Perhaps they were ordered to attack the strong point. But anyway, they suffered very heavy casualties when they encountered it, the same as all the men around him. They didn't make very much progress that day, although some men of other units did, and they swept all the way through to the village of Bocal. The Germans soon abandoned that. On the following day, a small squadron of tanks arrived and managed to capture the stronghold that had held up for so long. They took something like 800 prisoners from it. It was quite a coup. The Royal Naval Division were withdrawn for a rest. They suffered very heavy casualties as a result of that attack, and they spent 5 or 6 weeks in training before they returned. To the Somme. It was cold. It was very cold, and the ground was frozen. It was really difficult to dig any kind of trenches. Eventually, when the thaw came, the ground just turned into mud, and so many trenches that were dug just collapsed. So the only practical way to hold any kind of ground was just to use shell holes. So the piles of sandbags would be piled up around the rims of these shell holes, and barbed wire would be strung between. You'd have maybe 10 men and a sergeant or a corporal who led them, who would garrison those shell holes. And they would only be able to hold each one for about 24 hours before they were relieved. They're very dangerous places to be. There's very little cover, you couldn't move around. The shell holes were usually full of freezing water, so it was a very exposed position. There were a line of these around the village of Bocal that the Bedfordshires and the other men that were with them were to hold. It was a sort of a semicircle around the village. So if you picture a river behind you and the ruins of the village behind you, and a valley running away to your left or to your right, Germans are over that way, British are over that way. There's another valley running off in front of you, going around, bending around the corner like that. The British hold the high ground on the left, and the Germans hold the high ground on the right. The British hold a line across the valley, which curves back in towards you on your right-hand side. And it's that line that the Bedfordshires were holding when they first went there. Rather than the grand offensives of earlier on in the Somme, what the British started doing, which is extremely effective against a demoralised and weakened German army who were not in particularly good defensive positions, was to do lots of small-scale attacks to improve their position. And they started off by capturing the high ground on the right, and then they moved along the river, and they started to push towards the village of Miramont. The Germans eventually abandoned it and gave up. What happened after that high ground was taken on the right, and after another unit pushed forward on the left, was a sort of dip in the line. The line sort of came in like that, and then went back up like that, a re-entrant. So it was very difficult to defend, and it was also very impractical to use as a jumping off point for an attack. So a small operation was conceived to be launched 100 years ago today, in which the men of the Bedfordshires would advance by about 200 yards and they'd struggle up that line, and they'd find themselves a convenient row of shell holes and make new defensive positions there. So in the evening of the 11th of February, a creeping barrage began, advancing forward about 100 yards every 3 minutes, and the men of the Bedfordshires got up from their line that had been taped across the ground to show them where they needed to start from, and they passed forward. Unfortunately, they were quite an inexperienced unit, and they don't seem to have done the reconnaissance properly. They didn't realise that they were advancing into an area which had lots of barbed wire string around, and it slowed them down, and it made them an easy target for German machine guns. And they lost quite a lot of men in the attack. They reached their objective and came under heavy shell fire as they consolidated their position. They did achieve their objective, and the line was straightened at quite a high cost. One of the men that was lost that day was Albert Sycamore. His body was never found, and he's commemorated on the T-bar memorial to the missing. In Banstead, he's not on the war memorial in the High Street or the garden memorial in the churchyard. He's one of a small number of men who only appear on the panels in the memorial chapel there. And they were men with only a very brief connection to Banstead, it seems. Those that were had just moved into Banstead after the war had begun and were then lost. He was 29 years old. He left a widow, three children, and another one on the way, who arrived a couple of months after he died. She moved away briefly, and then moved back, and she'd been married to Albert's brother, in the end, and they went on to have several children of their own. We're now going to toll the bell 100 times in our memory. We have some volunteers from Gerrards Lane, the road that Bamba used to live in, who are going to help us out. So if you are able to stand, please do so.
They should grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not be with them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
Living and departed from this time forth forevermore.